so we hope.
Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through an audio recording, which will be used to ensure an accurate record of proceedings produced in the minutes of the meeting. All comments made in open session will be recorded. We have a notice of public, I'll read the notice of public hearing. Notice is hereby given that the planning board will hold a public hearing on Monday, August 8th at 7 p.m. in the planning board room, Town Hall, Pembroke, Mass. 02359, on the application of J.C. Pembroke LLC, care of James Costello, 38 Parish Farms Road, East Bridgewater, Mass. 02333, requesting site plan approval under the zoning bylaws of the Town of Pembroke, Section 5-7. Site plan approval for additional patio space next to the deck with a fire pit with additional seating. The property is located in a business district A, zoning district located at 300 Center Street, Pembroke, Mass. 02359. As shown as assessor's map C7, lot 25, as advertised in the Pembroke Mariner Express on Friday, July 22nd, 2016, and Friday, July 29th, 2016. Since the principals aren't here, should we make a motion to postpone? I move
that we adjourn for 10 minutes.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Any other business we can take up?
But we could talk, we can do the minutes and correspondence, which is the Selson Way, the tree. I guess which means locating, figuring out which tree it is, if it's one of the new ones that was put in or one of the old ones.
I didn't see anything in that. What's that?
There's a tree up on Selson Way. I guess DPW pointed out that a tree has died. Or
I will take a ride up tomorrow and verify that.
For Dandel?
For Dandel.
Okay.
Yeah.
I got the impression it was one of the new ones.
Well, we'll find out, Matt. We are responsible for it. I also, besides being a planning board member, I also work for Dandel. Okay.
And you guys guaranteed the work, so.
Yeah.
Okay, so that will take care of that. There's bills going around. If you guys can sign in that green thing.
Can I ask a question about the town center in the Smith property?
Yeah.
Did we allow equipment up front in our special permit?
Yeah, but how's he going to load it if you don't allow it up there?
Not for display.
He's not selling heavy equipment?
No, when I went by this afternoon, there was nothing up front.
There wasn't? Okay, because when I went by the other
was. Are you here for the public hearing?
For the restaurant?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're adjourning for 10 minutes. We're waiting for them to show up.
Okay. Yeah. Are you sitting here or are you going outside?
You can sit there.
This is it.
Yeah, the problem is that front becomes a working space. <It's not.
coughs> I didn't think they were supposed to be storing equipment.
Yeah,
front.
No, but the problem is that in the course of the day, early in the morning, truck pulls up, another truck pulls up. They're not going to keep moving that piece of equipment up back. They're going to keep it there.
You're going to be a little consumer walk-in type thing, and you park up front, and you get a couple of plants, and you get, no, what you permitted was a landscape operation.
Right.
End of the story.
No, I'm just,
get all the things you get with.
I'm curious as to how successful he's been with those piles. Mm-hmm. But that's his problem.
Don't forget, he didn't apply to June.
This
season's gone by.
It's the fall season.
Oh, well, it's going to get to next spring.
If you don't mind, can you just write down your name?
Well, it doesn't help if there's a construction zone all up and down Medicaid Street, which doesn't, no.
All right. We can also, I guess we can move this vote to appoint representative to long-term revenue and growth subcommittee that 8:15.
Just saying that would be recorded. Mm-hmm. As usual.
Which I think
so are there two things with this thing? One is the request for three-year plan.
Right.
That's going to be discussed at a one-on-one meeting to be determined. And who's going to attend it? I would assume you are going to attend the meeting?
I guess so. I wasn't planning on preparing a three-year operational plan or a five-year capital plan.
Well,
that was, wait a minute. That was sent around to departments that actually have.
Three-year and five-year capital.
Yeah, capital.
Like DPW.
This is not really for us.
Well, do we need to ask, you know, for example, if we ever hope in the next 3 years to get a computer or printer, do we have to speak now?
I don't think you need, I think that's different.
Might be a good time.
Yeah, but I think.
We bring up in our annual budget.
Unless you want to go for council, I mean, if you want to bring up having.
That's not capital.
It is if you're going to set up an annual account. It's looking towards, how do you do it? All right?
Yeah.
We've gone before this, before it was shut down. So, I mean, that would be one thing, because we don't really have a budget, and the annual budget for material is like $1,200.
Yes, not much. And advertising is the other big piece of the budget.
Right.
But what about something, just thinking from a capital standpoint, one thing we may want to consider is all these files getting scanned and stored properly. For quick lookup. I mean, that would be a capital.
Wait a minute. First off, when I put back to the master plan that we're talking about needing funding for,
yeah. That
may be the other thing.
That may be another thing, too. Yeah. And I think that.
And maybe some.
Well, this is good. We've got numerous ideas here. Let's write up all them and
send them up to the chief.
We talked about, you know, a planner position.
Yeah. And some of those capital. I'm not sure that's capital, but.
Well, no, it's also a three-year operational budget.
Okay. And then,
I'm sure if something like a computer falls into capital or operation.
I think
that sounds like capital to me, or a project that would scan everything and store it for us sounds like a capital expense to me.
It's a one-time, yeah.
Yeah.
I think you look at, who knows, but I do know that when it came out to all the departments that have, you know, actually have manpower and things like that. Well,
I wonder if there's any grants out there for planning boards to, you know, scan and store files for, you know, existing subdivisions. I wonder if it's worth peeking around and see if there's any money out there for that kind of project.
Yeah, but aren't we asking for stuff on disk anyway?
We do. We've always asked for stuff on disk anyway. We just never had anything to do anything with it. We've never had a computer we could load it onto or be able to view it.
The assessor's office does, though, and I think DPW might.
With third-party cloud storage or something that would give us the opportunity to access it.
Well, even if we got a scan or so, we start in the very near future, everything that comes in that we scan it and store it that way versus in files, it would at least stop the files getting bigger.
Yeah, because the letters we still get in hard copy form, we don't get those electronically for the most part.
But we can't scan
except
the piece of equipment that we have.
It would be an enormous undertaking.
I'm not sure what it is.
No, in order to do everything, yes, but going forward, won't that machine scan?
I think we need an assessment.
I think it probably does. I'm not sure.
Yeah. All right. So it's time to reopen the public hearing.
And we don't have our applicant here?
We do not have our applicant here, which I've never had this happen before, so I'm not really sure.
Did they make a motion
to continue the public hearing for 2 weeks until our next meeting.
All right. So we have a motion to continue.
Yeah, we do.
My only question is this. The applicant's not here, but the abutters are. And is there any...
really anything to
precedent for asking the abutters to express any opinions about the project before we continue the public hearing?
No.
So that they don't have to come back?
But as much as I
we're not holding a public hearing.
Well, it's open.
It's open. We have a public hearing underway.
Yeah, but as much as
we're missing an applicant.
I know, but as much as I hate to waste the
abutters. The applicant's the key
bag. Yeah, the abutters' time, which, right. You know, on behalf of the applicant, I apologize for. There's no one to answer their questions.
Right.
Or so, our questions.
Or our questions.
And we can't penalize them because they're not here.
Yeah. Right.
So all we have in action to do is to continue a public hearing.
I'll
if they choose
second.
Not in the future to not come again,
yeah. 2 weeks at a time certain.
Eventually, we will say, you don't have a site plan approval, building inspector, et cetera, cease and desist any continued permitting, and on we move.
Do you think they were confused by getting the selectmen's approval of the liquor and other permits that they didn't think they had to come back?
Mr. Chairman, do we have anything scheduled for 2 weeks from today?
That I do not.
At 7 p.m.? Or a date or a time certain?
Matt, do we have anything on the schedule?
I don't think there is an agenda yet for 2 weeks.
Okay.
I'll make motion, as I said, to continue the public hearing until which date, Matt?
It would be the 22nd.
22nd of August.
What time?
7 o'clock p.m.
Okay.
I apologize to you folks. So we have a first, we have a motion and a second.
Yeah.
So we'll be hearing this again on August 22nd at 7 p.m.?
7 p.m.
Yep.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Sorry about that.
Thanks.
You know, in the future, maybe liquor license and things shouldn't be given out until there's approval of the site plan.
Well, that is common sense, Bob.
Or a selectmen's decision.
All right, so we...
Maybe they should write a writing slip that everything's all set.
For liquor licenses.
Yeah, because really, it could be a board issue, and they give out a liquor license, sends the wrong message, doesn't it?
Should we ask George if he's had any contact with him about this?
He had to sort the...
No, he was leaving just as we came in.
What?
You were here for the bar?
Yes.
Old Oliveras?
Yes.
So we just continued it for 2 weeks because the applicant didn't show up.
Oh, you didn't? Okay.
So August 22nd at 7 o'clock.
Okay. How many people you expect to be or something like that?
Depends.
Just the applicant, usually.
Yeah, you and the other...
I live across the street from it, so that's the first time I've ever been here.
So sometimes a lot of neighbors show up for something like this, and sometimes no one shows up, except the applicant. But usually the applicant shows up.
My only complaint is guys pull out of there and they hit my mailbox. That's about it.
All right, well, we're...
Okay.
Take care.
Thank you for mine. We'll keep that in mind. As they occupy a single-family home somehow attached to a restaurant. Notice that?
The
next meeting, because like...
There's two cars there every day. It's like, that's not a single-family home attached to a restaurant, by the way. That's a restaurant with no residential attached to it. There is no mixed use in this town except in the center.
That used to be what, a pizza place or...
Oh, it's been a thousand things.
No, the other one, the small little White House.
They used it for a drive-through for about 10 minutes.
Right, it was a pizza place.
The only time we allowed people to live in there was when the owner,
their
principal residence burnt down.
Yeah.
And we said, we'll give you temporary ability to stay in the house while you get your life together. However, this man has no right to a single-family home on that lot. And consequently, get the hell out of it. How's that sound for the reporter?
Well, I...
Those are some of the things I was saying that don't necessarily need to go into the minutes.
But it'll be on tape.
Don't worry about it. Put it in there if you wish.
Well, I do recall that they had mentioned that the employees were going to be parking, so I don't know whether that's going to be parking there.
All right, so we have an informal site plan at 7:45, and so much for getting out early. Thought we were going to...
Question, wait, are they coming in?
Who? Oh, a couple of them. Would anybody else like to go?
No, thanks.
Wow, we're going to kill a lot of time here, huh?
Who's that informal site plan?
We're going to send it them in 7:45.
There you go.
I want them welcome to come in.
Great.
No, you're up, actually. It's your turn.
Are you by yourself?
Yeah.
Oh, come on.
Are this a meeting now?
You're right.
You're right.
All right, beautiful. Jeez.
Our 7 o'clock at the show.
Yes, a cancellation.
We're glad you're here early.
Put you on the express.
Yeah. Let's see, what the hell did I have? I got a property that's down there on Manakeset Street, right by what is it, Sylvester Lumber, the boatyard place there?
Yeah.
And I assume it's been on the market, I guess, for quite a while. You probably had it go through here four or five times. And I was just, I thought, I just wanted to know what would be acceptable there, because I assume they tried everything, houses and
Which lot is it?
Which lot is it? It's I believe it's 160. That's that boatyard place here, then they get the small house on there.
You're talking about the 5 acres?
Yeah, yeah.
Which one is this?
Is that right by Wintergreen?
Is it Wintergreen?
Yeah, Wintergreen Street runs right up there.
Oh, is there a lawn like?
Yeah, big lawn, finger lawn, yeah.
What's the frontage on the way?
86 feet, I believe it is.
You got a problem.
I know it. I think everybody's had a problem. My thought was, there's one house there, what I was thinking of doing is put another house on it and maybe have a retail out front, but that's like I said.
You don't get the frontage.
I understand.
So if you're gonna do retail, you're gonna have to have like 225 feet.
No, it's over 150 or something.
It's 150 residential.
That's in a business A zone. It's outside the, center protection district.
Yeah. So I didn't know what's allowable here with that 60, I mean, that 86 feet, even a house lot or something like that, what, required 150 or something?
150.
Yeah, so I didn't know if there's any use for this land or not.
Well, you're right about one thing, it's been presented before.
Oh, yeah, sure, because I know it's been up for sale, what, at least 8, 10 years or something like that, pretty close to it.
Well, originally, I think there was interest when Wintergreen was going in to purchase that property from whoever owned it at the time.
Yeah.
And that was prior to me even being on the board when that first portion of that went in. And they resisted selling it, because they could have picked up that property and probably incorporated it, I thought, at the time.
Into Wintergreen?
Yeah, in the first phase of that.
And they decided it was too expensive?
Well, no, whoever owned it didn't want it too much, or there was, you know how it goes when you think you get gold.
Yeah, it goes on. Hold on for the top dollar.
Right.
But I just didn't see, I mean, it's still for sale, and I didn't know what the hell you could actually put in there, to tell the truth. And from what I understand, I guess they wanted horse stables there, they wanted greenhouses there, they wanted flower shops, the houses, all that stuff. So I assume there's not too many things left to do, but.
We probably could have greenhouses there. That's about the only thing you could probably have.
Yeah, but you still have to have.
Farm use, you wouldn't be able to have structures or buildings.
Or retail sales.
No, you couldn't do that, but you could grow stuff there.
Well, there's one other thing you could do.
Solar, metal farms.
Yeah.
Solar farm.
Oh, solar farm.
Or a regular farm.
Yeah, solar farm?
That's about it.
Or a regular farm.
Who owns that piece?
Who owns that piece right there?
Next door.
The little triangle, I forget her name, but I asked her, she's not selling.
She's not.
Is that a single family home right next to it, right?
Yes, it is.
Both sides. I believe that was built by Habitat for Humanity.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Was that the one on the right side?
Yeah, which could have actually put that, all that property together.
No, I'm talking about on the other side. So there's a little one right here, and then there's this triangle here.
That little skinny.
Well, there's two houses on either side of that lot.
Right.
One is a house that's at the opening where that back commercial space goes, where you have some commercial operations.
That's Sergio?
Yeah, Sergio.
Yeah, I forget it was Sergio.
Yeah.
This piece here you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah, either way, it's proposed by other residential properties.
If we had pork chop lots, it would be perfect. But we don't.
Yeah, that's the only thing that goes there. You don't do the pork chop.
We don't do them. We pull them out along.
Yeah. Even then, it's probably not that much you're going to do in there. Put a house up, even on a pork chop.
In 5 acres?
Yeah.
In 5 acres, you could cut quite a few.
About a pork chop lot?
No. Well, we don't allow it.
No, I understand. It's just.
Our pork chop lot was 40 feet of road frontage.
But we had.
And 2.5 acres in size.
Remember, we had pork chop lots around in this area where some people think they have subdivisions.
Can't tell you what the building inspector issues a building permit for, and do whatever the hell he wants.
Well, is this?
You know, the objections of this board.
Right.
We'd have to take them to court to turn that decision around.
Is that correct?
This price is.
Yeah, that's a lot.
That's gone.
It's going to both sides. Kent Fabers.
Do you know who owns that property?
Is that where Kent Fabers, the boats?
Yeah, that's all.
Yeah. That's all boats there.
Because I was saying, you know, do you try to pull those two properties together?
That's, you're not going to be able to do that. You got enough problems, right? You got enough problems in that piece of property right now with violations of...
No, no, we need to talk about putting that...
You're talking about this.
Yeah, I'm saying...
She's talking about adding it to this one, which is...
Oh, I see.
Which is the one we have problems with constantly.
You got buildings here. He's got...
You have buildings around?
Yeah, there's a bunch of buildings there. And a cell tower.
Yeah. You got buildings over here.
He's got a cell tower back here.
I'm thinking that if this is going to have value, if somebody comes in here and he's done everything.
That's all built out already. We actually gave him the last lot.
You're right. But that doesn't help him.
No. Now, do you own this or you're thinking about buying this?
I'm thinking about buying it, but I wasn't going to buy it until I knew there was something you could put there. And then, well, it could be a one house, right?
No.
No?
No. Even though the house is on there?
Oh, the house is already there?
Oh, there's a house on there.
The house is there, it's there. But you can't take it down and put another one up.
Can't be being built in.
No, I mean, the house is there.
So you could renovate the house that's existing?
And a barn. There's a barn and an existing house on it.
That's it.
Basically, what it is, it's a house lot that if you take the house down, you never do nothing with it.
You're done.
Anybody live in there?
No, I don't think the guy's living there. It's probably vacant for a year anyhow. Maybe more, but the house is still there. Pretty good shape. It's just a small house.
It's like 600 feet or something. 600 is small.
Yeah, it's probably 20 by 25 or something.
Is that the barn though?
But this is showing...
Barn's a little bit bigger. Barn's probably a 24 by 30 or something like that.
I don't think it's 160. Is that the right address?
I don't, it was 154 across the street, so I think it's like 153, 155.
Yeah, it's not 160.
Something like that. There's no number on the fence or anything.
No, I'm on a realtor.
Well, I don't think you'd get any complaint from this board in terms of if you just replace what's there. Obviously, you would have rights under grandfathering, so... Yep.
Now, if you did that, could that house, that house could be enlarged to a standard size house anyway, so...
Sound not cool?
Oh, okay.
It's building inspector.
Okay.
You'd have to go to him and do what you're doing with us. Essentially, if you're grandfathering something, basically, we don't have any oversight.
Okay.
You know?
I was just, my main reason to have the meeting with you people is to see what was possible on that.
Yeah, you can't go ahead and haul in the hospital lands. Just depends on living there, it's probably fine.
That's about it.
It's a tough spot though.
Oh, it is. It is. It's a tough spot.
Because you come, even if you're coming out of there, it's like right on that corner.
It's a dangerous spot. I just had a hard time coming out of there.
Right.
It's all blind, all trees.
Imagine coming out of there, as you come out of the water.
Yeah.
Come down the hill.
Slip right on into the, and on the Manakisa.
Okay, let me, you answer some of my questions.
All right, good luck.
I'll just go with that. I guess I can take the next couple of weeks off. Okay, thanks a lot.
Looking for another piece of land?
Yeah, I know. A lot of the towns are starting to cancel those pork chop lots, huh?
Yeah.
Sure, a couple of other towns have changed it too.
Yeah.
Yeah, this has been, it's been going since, how long back? 20 years, 25?
Are there still quite a few of those around? Must be.
We have a fair amount. There was some about built.
Yeah. That even doubled the acreage, I mean, the doubled lot size, but from 30 to 60,000 to be the front house.
You have a problem in Millworth.
Yeah, it is. We've got a couple of others on the same way.
Probably a problem for five farmer too.
Okay, thanks a lot.
So to all these homeowners who want more land.
All right, so...
That the only thing you can do?
Well, I mean, a lot of that neighborhood is big on pools and things, so some of those people might not actually mind...
Or you buy a house there.
Having extra land to do something like that.
Some of you can buy a house, rip it down, even though it's been a lot for our brand road end. If the land was better than that piece of property, you weren't up against the thing. Now you could put like three or four houses maybe in that.
You're sitting on 150 to run a road in.
No, but that's why you buy a house on the green side.
Take the house down.
Take the house down.
Those are nice houses.
I'll pick it up and spin it.
Yeah.
Well, if it's worth $500,000 to buy the house lot and then you get the other property for nothing, maybe you make it work.
Yeah.
All right, so if we jump back to the appointing a representative for the long-term revenue growth subcommittee.
What about proposed road acceptance or equestrian?
Revenue growth?
They're coming in at 8:00.
Oh, okay, they're coming in, okay. So this long-term revenue growth subcommittee, this is a subcommittee of which board? Subcommittee of the Board of Selectmen?
Yeah. So we're gonna double our fees, okay, we're gonna generate a.
No, I think this is about revenue growth, meaning looking at other economic development in town.
Yeah.
But the top might maybe change, probably change our zoning or?
They're talking about from the other departments too, about a three-year plan, five-year.
No, but that's different from this long-term revenue growth subcommittee because we ran into Patrick the other night.
But isn't there only revenue taxation and that's based on what zones we have around town? So the other way we could actually grow revenue.
This is the email I got. Representative from the finance offices, Board of Selectmen and School Committee will come together to form a subcommittee devoted to long-term revenue growth. They have asked that a representative of the planning board join us to this subcommittee. So they'd like to appoint us to vote to appoint a representative to the subcommittee tonight.
So.
All right, so do you want this role?
I do not.
Do you want it? I mean, I'd be interested in if nobody wants to do it. I think it sounds interesting.
If you want to do it, do it.
Who's doing Old Colony Planning?
I'm the alternate, yeah.
Do you want to do it though?
To what, the revenue growth?
Yes.
We'd rather appoint somebody who wants this job.
Then I would be interested.
All right, so would someone like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we appoint Becky Coletta to the role of planning board representative to the long-term revenue growth subcommittee.
Second. So they're not coming in, are they? Are they?
All in favor?
Are they?
Aye.
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 What was that discussion? I'm sorry.
No.
Go ahead.
I said, are they actually coming in, or is it just, was that the end of it? I mean, I'm just looking at how we've collapsed this meeting time.
Who, wait, mean equestrian way?
Oh, no, are they actually coming in, or are we just discussing?
I didn't even know if we need to see them.
Well, maybe we get a call, can we get a call into them? And see if they can show up.
Is this Owen Kelly?
Yeah.
Well, we've only got, let's see.
Do we have an actual plan of it yet? And the answer is no.
Do we have an answer?
We don't have an as-built for the equestrian way. How are we going to talk about proposed road acceptance?
We can't.
Well, I mentioned to Matt the other day to contact the developer, whoever this representative of the developer was, because he would sought some opinion about whether they should come in or not.
Well, right. Okay. We also have a deadline, too. Right. We have to have the as-built in by about now.
Yes.
The exact date.
To hit fall 10.
I think it's August 12th.
Yeah.
So we have to grant an extension.
No.
They have to come back next year.
Right.
We discovered.
Oh, you're saying for road acceptance, right, because it's not hit our August deadline.
Correct.
Right, because they, you know, the week before town phone meeting.
How many times
they would be putting grass down and, you know, the phone meeting's all dead.
Yeah, but they're pretty well along on that stuff there. I mean, they're pretty done on everything. The only thing we're waiting for is the as-built, but most of the work that they've done, it's all done. I mean, the trees are in, everything's buttoned up.
Except cleaning up the front of it that drives me crazy every time.
Well, that would be one item that we'd want to be contingent. But the other issue, though, is that easement. That bothers me a little bit about.
Which easement?
There's an easement going into the back property that.
Fezzle. To go to Fezzle Lane.
But the easement is in such a place where there's no curb cut for it, and the landowner behind it has made clear her intentions to actually open up that easement now and start using it to get in and out of her property.
Where is it, though? So right now, if I go down
the last house.
Street,
oh,
yeah.
It's the very end. Go down Pheasant, you make a left in there, right?
But why would I need to go in that way? Because you can go in straight, right?
They were granted an easement when the subdivision was approved. And that easement's there.
She's playing puzzle.
Because
I can explain why it's an easement there.
Okay.
To recall, we have a 1,000-foot dead-end street restriction, right? So the plan is, if you use the easement, and turn it back into Pheasant Lane, you don't have a dead-end road. You just have a big
loop.
So, the abutter, Melissa Deloche, who's been well-known in town, had sought this easement at the end of this way. Board granted it. The hope is that she'll get rid of her pig farm, ostrich farm,
emu's
kangaroo farm, emu farm, whatever she's calling it recently farmed, and that she would be able to loop and come back out onto Pheasant Lane, and there would be house lots granted around the way.
Oh, so
it's a money maker.
So the expectation was at some point that if you look at
correct
Pheasant going into equestrian.
Now, here's one thing we can't require.
How do you put a road over somebody's property even if there's an easement?
But what I don't understand, so that makes sense to me, right?
We granted the easement for the purpose of getting access into the back of a lot.
For future use.
But not for a road.
No,
so, Brian, she can come out here, or she can come out the existing entrance exit. What I don't understand is if she has a permanent easement granted, why would she start to use it now?
First off, does she actually...
And furthermore, even if she wanted it, even though there's an easement in the ground, whose cost is that? Hers?
Hers, usually.
Yeah. So Paul's saying, or somebody said, yeah, you know, it's blocked off, there's no, oh, maybe he said, signs of it in the way. Well, who builds that?
Well, she'd have to.
Well, first off,
there's right, not one there.
Well,
says, in fact,
well,
except the
road,
your opinion, then
she'd have to go,
she
to
has to go build it. She has to go build it if it's accepted.
No, she'd need a permit from DPW to go.
Yeah, but if it's accepted,
take the curb up and move it.
So we didn't impose the cost upon him or this developer.
But if we accept it, then DPW has to deal with it, so let's accept it.
Who owns the easement?
The easement was given by the developer to the owner.
It was given.
The easement.
Who owns the property that the easement
is on?
The homeowner at the
end. The homeowner at the end. So if you want to put a road across my property, you're going to buy it.
Yes, that's my point.
Right.
There's only an easement, there can't be a road.
Right. It's not.
And if you don't come to an agreement, you don't have a deal.
You got it.
Right.
It's not really.
We knew we were blocking the rain.
I would love that easement.
Sorry.
I would love that easement.
Well, there was also the other reason that went in is we also gained property for open space.
Yeah, I know. I understand that. That I understood.
Right.
But
and it was upland.
People can walk across that, but you can't if you're going to put a road in. That's a
well. She has no curb cut.
Right.
It wasn't like it was designed for a road for
it's
access.
It's a matter that's unresolved in terms of getting access.
What is the gentleman's name who keeps coming in?
Owen.
Owen. Do we have a phone number for him?
So we have a phone number for Owen?
Yeah, you should have a number for him.
Tracy gave it to me. I'm not sure if I still have it.
But I wouldn't rush to accept the road.
Well, the only thing is, first off, is that the as-builts have to be in hand, number one.
To start with.
The road, you know, the idea is that you're going to end up being able to go out there and walk very quickly to look at this. If it's not complete, it's not complete. There is issues on the front.
Matthew, you might want to try in the folder to see if there's a folder for equestrian and look.
But I don't want to keep extending it.
Okay.
And then all of a sudden, in September sometime, looking at this thing is being finished.
If they hadn't met the deadline, just to go, guys, you didn't meet the deadline. So you
haven't met the deadline.
What are we talking about? They're talking about...
Acceptance.
No. We're talking about them picking up the dime on snow plowing.
Exactly.
Okay? Right. Until next April. So, sorry, if you don't show up, you didn't hit the deadline, that's the way it goes. That's
but they, for all we know, they're bringing in the as-builts tonight.
Right. Well, they could be. But there is further improvements we should send out our engineer.
Usually what happens is the as-built goes to Merrill to review the as-built, review the project, and report to us. And
I was down there a week ago. There's a lot of little stuff that's still done. You know, at the top of the road where Becky just pointed out, all those cobble, all that vertical curving.
Right. Yeah.
There's no backfill, and there's no joint compounding, if you will.
Right.
In terms of the concrete that goes between the sections, all of that is detail work, but nevertheless, it's not been done.
Right.
You got some spaces in between the vertical.
First off.
Granite curving that are like this.
It's not right.
Well, it's.
Just butt up against each other.
Yeah, exactly.
As soon as the ASBIL.
You go up and look at it, you're gonna see what I saw.
So as soon as the ASBIL comes in, then the board asks our engineer and DPW to go look at it. But if it's not here.
Yeah, I don't think we're rushed to approve that.
No. What's that?
Was it August 12th?
All you're doing is.
I think it's August, yes. August 16th, it's in.
Yeah, we're in the right time.
Yeah, we're in the issue. It's in the middle of that.
We're not gonna meet again, obviously, until at least August 20th.
So they don't have it in here tonight, yeah.
Yeah, we know we're behind our own.
I think we had to, like, have the opportunity to go out and walk it beforehand, August.
Just remember, we're always having the catch basins, all that, we used to have to go out there.
It was more, I think it was mostly the grass and trees and stuff, so we could see that it made it through winter, and here we are.
One thing's for sure, once we bring it up for acceptance, if it isn't up to our full conditions, why would we want to approve it if there were?
Well, the only thing, the only.
There's not no incentive.
Right, but the only.
No compelling reason for us to have to accept it, so we don't think it's 100% right.
But also, as a taxpayer, I don't wanna take and put something on the warrant that costs us to print, costs us to go up and then defend that we've taken it off.
So then we have to take it off.
If we, why, if it's not worth, they're not, have the time to get it to us right away.
But there's, well, you gotta get it to us in time, in fact.
Right.
Yeah, understood, but they're also scheduled to be here at 8 o'clock, and we haven't given the opportunity to talk.
No, they never come through.
We'll just plan ahead.
However, given that it's not 8 o'clock, could we go back to subject?
Yes.
Now we've got a representative to the long-term revenue growth subcommittee. Maybe we can have some talking points for our representative, what I think they're looking for.
Okay, done.
Where are the areas of growth in the tax base? It's a fundamental part. There's not another department on here, you know, that raises revenues really, except for maybe the assessors, and through the use of assessment and taxation. The key point this board plays is, what are we looking at as developable? We approved doggy daycare, we've approved the mental health condition place. We're looking at five buildings on Oak Street that wanna go up. We have several acres of land up in that area that is certainly developable. I mean, we could raise potentially, if that whole thing we developed out, $500,000 a year. That's revenue they're not even counting yet. I was watching one of the meetings a few weeks ago, they're all up and they wanna sell ball signs in the ballpark. And say, come on, guys, think bigger, come on. We gotta think town-wide.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter how many signs you sell in the baseball field.
Well, sometimes.
Do we have enough room up there for a small hotel?
Yeah.
You think there's enough room there behind Stop and Shop?
For two.
Oh, yeah. I mean, take out the, you gotta think too, not only what's in the ground, but what is it redevelopable as?
What's already cheap enough that it could be redeveloped?
Listen, some of those buildings.
The guy comes in here a year ago or so from.
The ball tennis.
The landscaping place too, not only the ball court place, right?
Yeah.
What can I do on my lot? You know, what a lack of imagination when you think about it. Solve my problem, I can't think. You know, look at it any given day in any city area you go. Something's here for 20, 30, 40 years, and the next day it's gone and something comes out big.
Yeah, you could take.
Take a look at New York City.
Yeah.
Okay, when you can't think wide, think tall.
You are right, where is the nearest hotel? It's never gone, right?
Back in the original master plan, we even made provisions to put a hotel.
Yes, we did.
We increased the height.
We brought in the words hotel, and we brought it to four stories, and we did, 15 years ago almost.
Right.
Right, so my point for long-term revenue growth is new growth.
What about, this is just a question, what about, I know we we have application, developers, when they apply, they're paying basically engineering fees. Do we charge just a flat application fee?
Yeah, there's a fee.
Yeah, that's the $2,500, or whatever we decide if it's a minor.
Yeah, $1,000, whatever, that goes into the general fund.
Yeah, but I mean, that's, I think, to Brian's point, that's nibbling at the edges with fees.
Right, right, but I'm just saying, you know, do we kind of stop doing the, you know, oh, it's Joe Smith, it's like $250.
Yeah, but we also want to encourage that growth, and we want to encourage some development that's going to add to the tax base.
Right.
Rather than hit them with upfront fees.
Right.
I've never seen us waive a fee, though, when you get RK centers, for instance, comes before us. Oh, we're poor little guys, can we get half the cost? No. You're a multi-billion-dollar company.
But usually, they're some of the easier people to work with, because they understand how zoning works, they understand development.
But like 300 Center Street, we didn't try to stand in their way with a large upfront fee.
Well, because it's already.
Because it's already built, and we were just looking for methods.
So they paid, $500 was the fee, and then the $1,500 was the engineering.
But I think if we go back to the master plan, and we go back to thinking about where development should happen, that Route 3exit there is a perfect place to attract something that would add to the tax base significantly.
Right.
So, you know, I think part of it may be, you know, we don't have a Pembroke economic development, spokesperson or director who could go out and do that. That may be a role that we could find for someone who's already, you know, an elected position or doing something related, you know, to planning. Right. So that's a role that we may want to look at trying to beef up a little bit to actually go out and court some of these larger companies who may be interested in coming to Pembroke. If you remember, Pembroke Woods was going to expand big. That land is still there.
Right.
But that's
and that's a perfect place for a hotel, by the way. The other thing is, with that corporate park, the nice thing about the prospects for a hotel there is business travelers.
Yeah.
You've got companies that do international business. Protector Wire is right, not too far away from there, and they do a huge business overseas.
Industrial.
In Asia. They've got people from Asia coming to Pembroke all the time. So there's definitely a...
Over in Marshall, this industrial, that whole where WATD is, there's a ton of stuff.
Exactly.
I know what's up in there.
There's a lot of good businesses that are international businesses would benefit from a hotel being close by. Easy access to Logan Airport when you think about it, down Route 3. We've got a great space to attract something like that.
I always wonder if it makes sense.
You haven't driven on Route 3 lately, have you?
Does it make sense for us also to even reach out? So the guy who was in here with Corporate Park, used to be his dad and now it's him, who came in asking to clear land to make it easier for people to envision what can happen on that land behind Stop and Shop.
Yeah.
So worth reaching out to someone like that and saying, hey, how are you doing?
Yeah,
absolutely.
What can the town do?
Absolutely.
You know, what?
There's nothing that says we can't take a proactive approach to that.
Brian Murphy. Who was Brian now? It's not Bill anymore.
Brian Murphy? Says name, I can't remember.
What about the, I know that it's a small chunk of land, but what about the, another raised ranch that was the septic place?
Yeah, that's a small piece.
That's a small one.
I think Tomasi bought that.
You think he did?
I think so.
I think there's people.
Who did?
I think Tomasi.
No, I'm just wondering how to get that developed.
I thought you were saying
Tomasi. Well, the Kiss site is ideal for a couple of things.
The car dealership.
Car dealership.
Yeah.
Number one. I mean, car dealers today love
the visibility on Route 3.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, put Mercedes-Benz up there, et cetera, and you get thousands of cars going by. And they're more than willing to get off the highway and go to your
perfect
place.
Perfect spot is across from Doggy Daycare. And then take that land that goes right down to that, where they have the moving company.
Yeah.
That moving company is a lot of wasted property right there.
Huge.
Yeah.
All right, and you could put a hotel with conference rooms right in that, those five lots. Conference center right there.
How much land does RK own on the backside by the 99?
No, they
only have enough for a building.
Yeah, there's not much there.
It's
right footprint up against Route 3.
I see what they've cleared, but that's all they own?
That's it.
Yeah. Okay. I'm not even sure
that's it.
I think they're gonna have to borrow some of the parking lot for Lowe's to do that, right?
No, they own that road.
No, I know, but where are they gonna park cars?
They'll change all the parking.
Yeah.
They'll probably pull that parking right down.
All the way out.
All the way up.
And not use it as a road anymore.
Correct.
Right.
So, from a perspective of the most desirable, I think that area there is the most desirable. And then we should think about some other parts of town where we've thought about zoning for memory care or for assisted living.
Down to sandbaggers?
Yeah. Which lend themselves to that kind of development because they're a little bit off the beaten track and they're kind of bucolic.
Plus the concrete company got sold.
And we...
But they've got good access. They still have good access.
We did propose...
Yeah.
Assisted living facilities for that area, but it was turned down at town meeting.
So maybe if we have more of a justification for it?
Well, maybe if you had a selectman, I'd back you a little bit.
Well, I think that...
Well, I think with the memory care, we had a real case in point, and that made that easier.
Well, I think we're looking for more assisted living.
Yeah, we're looking for assisted.
The memory care is...
Well, it doesn't matter how...
Well, I think too, once we turn the corner...
They're all the same, they're all the same bag.
If you want to put memory care on it, sounds good to me. You want to put assisted living...
Look at it from the perspective of the Wells companies with Allerton House and Village Ducks.
Oh, yeah. Bigger development.
Potential.
Yeah.
What about 139?
139. Not built sites on 139, outside of where we were talking about up at the...
How big is the lot where the landscape supply that is behind on Oak Street?
Who, Tomasi?
No, not Tomasi, on the other side, on the east side of Route 3. There's a landscape, yeah, there behind the...
Oh, right behind the bagel place.
Yeah.
That goes back to the question that was raised here, though, about the non-residential frontage because of the naming of streets, for instance. That's a good example where the town has permitted a business to go in, but you'll never see Union Street as an allowed way.
Yeah.
But it may have been variance.
And that happened several times. We gotta go back in and revisit that bylaw because you start getting into the particulars. You know, it's like a half a dozen streets in town named as adequate ways, and that's not the way it's occurred. It's not the way it's been built out.
Well, and that was what...
It's a false defense.
Attorney Galvin was saying there have been a lot of variances on that. And so the question is, at some point, if you give too many variances, you should change the rule.
Yes.
It shouldn't be a variance. It should...
That's not a reason for denial either.
But, well, the variance...
All right, we don't even...
We might not want to go down this slippery slope.
Anyway, what I was gonna say is that...
Depends on how you use this.
As you guys are talking, it's occurring to me, I don't know about anybody else, that really what we're talking about is master planning.
Yeah, we've been...
But you know what?
We've been here before. But the point, to Tom's point, is that, yeah, it's a very buildable site, that one that you're referring to.
Right.
The one behind the old movie theaters in Sherwin-Williams, et cetera. Like 5, 6, 7 acres in that area. It's fully buildable. You would have to literally take that section of the town, go lot by lot by lot, essentially, to do a true presentation for something like this.
It could be a marijuana place.
Here's a buildable place, here's a buildable lot, here's a buildable lot.
It's allowable.
I'll tell you, they're looking for, if they could find $100,000 in the selectman's office this year of new revenue, they would be ecstatic.
They'd probably have it spent.
You know, 10 years ago, when we were going through the subdivision, we had members, Jerry Dempsey, you guys on the ZBA, astonished by the new growth rate in town. Of new growth being new revenue, not depopulation.
Right.
But new revenue growth, which is on the assessors department, you know, you got your existing assessed base, and then all of a sudden you've got new growth.
Which is on top of your 2%.
Correct.
2.5%.
So if the other night I'm listening to the selectmen's meeting or something, I don't pay much attention to those things, but nevertheless, you know, they're looking at, ooh, we have a pension liability of $800,000. It's gonna crush us. It's gonna hurt the party.
That's just...
Whatever, I don't know what the real number is. But my point is, well, if you've got 10 years to make up $1 million or $2 million or $3 million, certainly helps if you've got $200,000 of new revenue growth per year for 5 years.
Come on in.
You follow me, Tom?
Yeah.
I do, 100%.
So all you really do is go up and document that area up there and say, here's what could happen. And you're worried about either new taxes, a 2.5 for override, or are you worried about new growth? Because new growth is not a 2.5 override.
New growth, his new growth.
Right.
Right.
New commercial growth is a little cheaper.
Let's put it that way. Residences typically run more than the benefit of, to the community.
The trees?
It's all your fault.
But I guess part of what I think is, well, this is all the more reason to invest some amount of short-term money.
Just talking about the plans.
Yeah.
So that you can bring in the long-term money.
I don't disagree with that, but we can't wait for another master plan to get started.
I don't know.
You mean in terms of getting some growth in quickly? And you're saying there's already plans on the books and bylaws on the books and money?
Well, we may need to change some bylaws or some zoning in a certain part of town.
But not the area we're talking about.
But it's not impossible to do.
No, but it's tough. It's tough.
I know, but it's not impossible to do, so it's something we should put on the table. And a lot of the things that a new master plan would uncover, things that the last master plan already uncovered.
Yeah.
So, I think the idea is to really get started on it, because we know where the areas are where we could attract that kind of revenue.
I think you could start looking at 27, too.
Yeah.
Well, I'm thinking hotels, because that brings in some local tax.
But also brings in other business.
Well, also brings in room tax money.
Well, brings in room tax money, but it also brings in other business, like restaurants.
Other spinoffs, if we're going to come out of that. But when we looked at this initially, and we went back to the business community at that time, and we did a master.
It's harder to change it once you've
12, 14, 13 years ago, what have you. We brought them into the discussion, if you recall. The Murphys.
Yep.
What do you think you need? Type thing. You know, discussion. I mean, just, and I'll just kind of say something. I know we have a fellow here for our purposes. We went to 4 stories from 2.5 stories. And I hope, for instance, that would attract business, right? And we were told that. It wasn't just a guess. And we said, well, you know, if you raise your building height level, you know, you might attract a hotel, for instance. Well, now these types of steps going forward might be the types of things that we have to reconsider, because, well, what if we said it's 6 stories, 8 stories?
How does a particular hotel change?
In other words, where does that end?
Well, that's it. I think we need to
reach out.
We got to bring in new ideas to keep trying to get it.
Maybe they're just assuming there's a 2-story height restriction. They don't even know they've got a 4-story height restriction.
Right.
And would be willing to go to 6 in that area.
So maybe I should have copy with
you
before we
Again.
All right. So, sir, we're... Are those as-built plans in your hands?
Yeah. So I just wanted to check in to see, you know, how you guys wanted to run the process.
Yep.
This is our first as-built process in Pembroke. So do you want us to distribute them to different boards? Or I know Peter's going to get a copy to review. You guys obviously need a copy to review.
Do we want to do a site walk down there? Do you guys have questions?
Yeah. Of course, we have Peter go look at it.
Okay.
Yeah. I think
DPW, too.
Yeah, don't we typically have our planning board assistant distribute the plan?
Yes.
Yes.
How many copies are supposed to be, though?
Right.
How many copies are supposed to be?
I thought there was 7.
7.
Okay.
7 or 8.
So I have 4 here. I'll get you more, obviously.
Yeah. Is that the whole subdivision?
Yeah.
One of the questions we were talking about was timing.
Yeah.
Because we're kind of running tight against the timing for fall.
Yeah.
So we need the as-built plans in.
He's got them right now.
No, but I mean, we need more copies to start.
Yeah, I'll have them to you tomorrow.
Basically, you know.
I just wanted
Peter has to approve everything, and everything has to be done by the 15th of this month.
Correct. Yeah, and I talked to Peter. I went over a little bit of the process with him. But like I said, I just wanted to check in here. And like I said, I don't mind pushing, you know, getting things out to different boards and stuff like that to make sure everybody has what they need.
I think the board may be thinking that, you know, we're looking for that stone wall area to be cleaned up and some other stuff, I think.
And that's actually, that is on the books. We just didn't want to see it until it cooled down a little bit, so that way it didn't just, it didn't burn out right away. We can do it now and then, you know, write a letter saying we'll do it again too, if that's more preferable to the board.
Well, I would tell you right now is that right now.
Yep.
Whether you think so or not.
Yep.
Is actually the, I think it's the first 2 weeks or first 3 weeks of August is actually the best time to seed.
Perfect.
All right, because you get high temperatures in the daytime, low temperatures at night, allows the seed to snap open, number yep. one. But you're gonna have to water it or hydro seed it. But the reality is that we normally want an established situation, so I would suggest you hydro seed it as soon as possible.
Sure.
Because if it isn't up growing by the time we go to accept it, I'll be voting no.
Well, we usually want to see it go through a winter too.
Correct. But it's more for the tree. It's not, well, it's not, they haven't established anything. They haven't established anything yet. But the point is that right now, even though it's hot and dry, and the idea is you go out and you maintain it a little bit to get it established, but this is actually the right time.
Great.
I would also point out, I inspected the property recently on the roadway. All the vertical granite curbing up on the front,
yep.
particularly at the radius, all has to be filled, pointed.
Yeah,
pointed. Masonry pointed. And again, just the buttressing of the soils, etc., at that radius. Everything else seems to be in pretty good shape.
Okay.
But I would pay attention to those things, and at the cul-de-sac area, I think also you got to take a look at some appointment in there in terms of your cement work, etc.
Okay.
I think there were areas in there that had been...
In the cul-de-sac?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I would say the radius at the top of the street and the cul-de-sac area at the bottom of the street should get some attention.
The other
Otherwise, thing, I thought it was in pretty good shape.
The other thing you got to realize is that, let's say this does go on to the docket to be accepted.
Mm-hmm.
All your catch basins have to be cleaned out.
Yep.
Your detention area has to be cleaned out.
Yep.
Make sure it's in functional.
So, right? Top shape.
So everything has to be like pristine before we're going to take and put it on the tax bill. Yep.
I think that's what Peter was talking about. And that's the step in the process here. We'll take all the comments
right.
and make sure that everything is met.
Plus the DPW will be like inspected too.
Right. Final punch list.
Right.
Excellent. All right. So you're going to get us more copies?
So I'm going to get you, you want 8 copies then,
eight
just
copies.
In case?
8 copies Great. Sounds terrific.
Perfect. So I'll get you 4 more copies of this here. Do you want me to leave?
You can leave that.
Yeah, leave those. Yeah.
Okay, great.
And then I'll leave? Bring 4 more.
Great.
All right, great.
Thank you all. Okay.
So do you want me to do any distribution or Matthew will handle
it? Matthew will do it.
Okay, great. Yeah. If you guys would like to do a site walk with me, he has... my number.
We'll make an appointment.
Yep, absolutely, anytime.
We want to get Peter's report first.
Yeah.
So we'll send...
We'll get Peter and the DPW
no.
to give us...
Actually, I'm going to take one of these
so
Peter
and the DPW look at it before
I'll
we
I'll bring you guys back.
Then we see what the issues
right.
are. And then we know what to look for.
Do we know what's in the engineering account in this case?
I can check the revolving.
Yep.
I know we updated it with Marilyn... last after the big paving,
mm-hmm.
so like in the springtime, and we haven't had anything for Peter since then, besides a couple small inspection reports. So it
yeah.
should be full,
should be something
or
in
relatively full. Yeah,
okay, ample enough to cover mineral associates.
Let's just make sure that
right, yes.
make sure you understand one thing.
Yeah,
if we're short on your account now and the Merrill bill came in, you'd be responsible for the payment.
All right, good. So yeah, we got about $4,500 in there.
All right, you got sufficient funds.
Right.
Yeah. All right. I'm happy with where we are.
Good.
Thank you.
Okay, great.
Yep.
This is groundwater fed.
And then how do I collect the comments? Do I come in a couple weeks to another meeting here? Or
we'll schedule a meeting with you
at some point prior to the town meeting, which won't take effect until like late October.
Right.
So we'll probably meet you roughly a month from now.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense.
Okay.
Beginning of September. I'm sure Peter and I will talk before then too. If he has any big cut.
He has any comments?
And everything's squared off and all the workmanship's been done and the things we just discussed? I don't see any problem.
Can you just point out something real quick? One of our requirements is that all the underground utilities are shown plus or minus a foot horizontally and vertically.
Yeah.
There's none shown here.
Sure. Great.
So these aren't really adverts, huh?
No. We've got a hydrant, we got no water line, no electric, telephone, we need it all the way through.
Have them put it on.
Horizontal and vertical.
Gotta do it all.
Okay.
So take those back.
We'll take all of them back.
Have these refilled.
Can we look one just in case somebody wants to look at something?
Absolutely. All right, thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night.
Thanks.
Thanks, Andy, appreciate it.
Yeah.
So when he gives them to me, then I'll just distribute them to you.
Jim, make sure Matt's aware of what you just pointed out on it. This is a learning process, Matt, and you should be aware of these types of things. When somebody comes in and drops a set of plans on you and says, here's my plan.
Well, you know, it's a giveaway, too, is they only have two sheets.
Yeah. Yeah, that's typically.
Where's this? Heads
up. This is for road acceptance situation.
Yes. We want all utilities shown plus or minus a foot horizontal and vertically, so we should see all utilities in the profile.
Like, yeah. One of the things I was thinking is, where are these pieces of data? Is there planning board
We
haven't distributed.
We assume they have telephone.
Somebody has to pull some rates. I don't know if you have a copy of that.
Yeah.
It's a separate document. But there's two other documents that are critical.
And that also has all the plates in it.
The subdivision rules and regulations.
No, that's the master.
I don't have
my The site plan rules and regulations. There's two separate things.
But it's good to learn.
But they're both.
This is all.
They're both supporting documents.
So the problem
The issue with the target was not still was missing. Right, something's wrong.
Yeah.
But it's just updated? Well, that's from 2005.
So the problem is that, like,
it's about right for site plan.
So the connections are not
shown. Well, of course, yeah, you're not.
What I'd expect to see is like.
Is this the only one, or is there another one for subdivision?
Yes,
subdivision. There's a separate one for subdivision.
Rules and regs for subdivisions.
Subdivision rules and regs and site and the separate one for.
And also, you're saying that the elevations should be given here too?
But then I saw each of
the hydrants and that.
There's something that was like conditions.
It would be in the
When we took over site plan.
Probably the conditions of all the rules and regs.
We've
been better off showing that to them.
And the zoning board previously had site plan.
They had no elevations there either.
They showed us
three paragraphs.
Three gate valve.
Yeah, it looks like it. Yeah.
Yeah. And three valve.
Nothing. They didn't tell anybody how it was going to get done, what they required.
So we have a couple of master plans.
Is this the new road too, or is this
existing? Those are both amenable, by the way.
Subdivision, right?
We did it.
And if you ever, when you read I hope you will, read through those, then, you know, those are amendable not by town meeting.
By us.
You don't require an action at town meeting. And any of the conditions in there? That we waived a requirement to go to the ZBA, for instance.
Did we keep a...
They don't need a variance, right?
No, that easement.
We can waive our own rules and regs.
Well, that easement comes around this town-owned property to the opening, correct?
Right. We own the sidewalk and the curb.
Right, so she wouldn't necessarily have right to pass over the sidewalk.
No. Right? She can't. That's an easement, which means that it's...
In an emergency...
For access,
right?
But it doesn't give you the right to build a road.
No, but she already has frontage for the main road.
No, she doesn't.
Pheasant.
Yeah, no. Off
well, 1,000 feet.
I guess this stuff is also.
Oh, it would be more than 1,000 feet. Then?
Well, she sits back about probably 600.
Right. No, she wanted to. Yeah,
we'll say 400, maybe right. 500. Okay, but nevertheless, if you set 1,000, that means they're going to get 300.
Right. She wanted.
Her anticipation is she gets it. She wanted a loop. Looping she subdivision. Wanted a loop.
There's always a scam on this particular thing.
Where are the cassette tapes?
We'll let them fight it out. You know, if it's enough work, going back on that decision, if it's worth enough for them to create that and open that easement, buy out the property interest of it, go for it. Otherwise, you got nothing.
I think we kept it.
You got a couple of house lots.
Be accessed.
And that's that.
I entertain a motion to adjourn, if someone wants to do that.
Do we have, do we have?
Well, I'm singing your song right now.
We have a set of minutes coming.
Okay.
But Marilyn, you're finishing up the minutes that Marilyn started.
Yeah, well, I don't think she hadn't started it, so.
Okay.
Could I have one more thing?
Yeah.
I'd like to put on the agenda for the next meeting, that we review the mixed-use development zoning bylaw for the center of town. And I may be proposing at that time, although not until the August 22nd meeting apparently, maybe we should simply remove it. But I want to discuss whether that should be stricken from the bylaw. And then we'll have to take it up. But,
we should have probably a formal.
Here's why it's important at this juncture in time. If we were to propose such a thing on August 22nd, we probably have just enough time to get it to the fall meeting.
Okay.
Because we'd have to have a public hearing.
Public hearing, place, we have to have all the things with it. But it's time to talk about the mixed use.
Mixed use.
Whether we.
The mixture requirements.
Or change it somehow, or.
You mean allow mixed use, but not.
No, get rid of that article.
So it'd be all commercial or it'd be all residential?
Hold it, Ken.
No, it's commercial, no.
Commercial zones, so it'd be no residential use.
You know, mixed, only on the mixed use property. Residence A can exist in the center, but it's a single family house lot, 150 foot of frontage, 40,000 square feet of area.
Two plots.
Can't be a variety of other things, mixing it,
Yeah, it has, doesn't affect, the only thing that affects is, all affects is the, we have one of them proposed right now.
Right.
We have one in contemplation, yeah.
Well, he's got it in front of us.
But why wouldn't we want?
Who's got it in front?
Multifamily in the center.
McGill.
He hasn't got an application.
I think he does.
No, he hasn't. And who asked?
Didn't you have, did he have a public hearing?
No.
No.
He came in informally.
I guess we can talk about it.
He came in informally.
Well, that's all right.
No, don't forget what the legal status is of a change in this case, even if there is a party that brought up. They have no formal application, period. Once you advertise this in the local paper, that's the effective date of the town meeting. Adopts it. Not, if we act alone, right, once it's gone in, essentially, we've brought the issue forward.
Right.
If he comes forward with no application, he's lost his shot. If we notify him, if we wish, that we're contemplating this, and if you're going to do something, sir, come forward now, because if you don't bring that application in, submit your application, if town meeting approves our action, you're done.
Wait a minute, I thought we did.
Go away.
I understand why we don't want. We can talk about this, I guess, in 2 weeks. I just don't understand why we don't want multifamily around the town center, because it creates a more walkable.
I'd welcome. The reason for the thing was the
was to create it.
The article was.
Based on a restaurant.
The reason that we wanted, we did what we did, was in fact to do the conditions you want. The problems become is that with an unwielding ZBA, you don't know if you're going to get all housing and no commercial.
No commercial in the air.
And they put that uncertainty in the air. They granted Mr. DiMaggio five variances on a request for two.
Multifamily dwellings in the center, would you suddenly start getting restaurants and other stuff happening?
Jim, it's been bastardized. All we asked for is a 50-50 mix.
Yeah.
All we asked for is to keep within certain square footage.
Right.
But you've got a board that just
haven't got it, though.
Throws the rule out. Yeah. And so how do we anticipate going forward with that sort of
thing? So it's on the agenda for the 22nd, plus the continued public hearing,
yep.
Hopefully.
And then you have certain stuff, right?
Motion. A motion to adjourn.
I second.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.